Good morning, everybody. How many of you feel that machine learning will be one of the basic technologies that we will be building the future on? All of you. How many of you truly understand how machine learning works? Now there are some people are being too modest. I know that some of you definitely understand it, but there were no hands raised. So how come? If you feel this is one of the basic technologies that we will be building our future on, and none of you truly understand how it works, even excluding the two modest ones. I'm sure there were some who really don't understand how machine learning works. So what's wrong with us if we see something that we feel, we believe, is very, very fundamental, and yet we don't take the trouble to learn it? And this is exactly where I was 6 months ago. I did some Lisp language-based NLP work in the 80s, which didn't end too well. Then I sort of forgot about AI topics in practice or on a practical level for a long time. In 2006, in F-Secure, the company I founded, we started using neural networks to identify malware. It didn't work too well back then either. The computational requirements were just a bit too high. And around 2012, the real renaissance of AI or machine learning began. And then I started reading books about it and articles and talking to researchers, but I never truly understood how it works. And then I had this awakening that actually I had forgotten what it is about to be an entrepreneur. Because an entrepreneur acts. You see a problem, you think that, okay, maybe other people have the same problem. Maybe I can build a product. I'll start a company. That's how many great companies are started. Or you see an opportunity, and you don't wait somebody else to take that opportunity. You think, maybe I will take that opportunity. And you refuse to be defined by the role you have. We all can learn. We all can start coding again. And that's what I did. So I started, after a break of almost 30 years, I started doing some fairly serious coding. And it's so much fun. And my opinion about machine learning changed. There were some things that I had misunderstood, just based on reading and talking to people, because I had no framework of reference of my own to question what I heard. I just had to believe. I based my judgment on how credible the person speaking was. And I believed almost everything if I thought that the person is credible, because I didn't understand the topic myself. And once again, I learned the same old lesson, that if something is important, do something about it yourself. And what I started doing is creating a short presentation, the kind of a presentation that I would have hoped somebody would have given me. But nobody did. And therefore, I didn't understand. So I hope that I can deliver some of the intuition, which I feel is important for anybody who is involved with technology, to you now. So I'll try to briefly explain why machine learning is so topical right now, what it truly means, not at a deep technical level, but at a level of intuition. And then I hope that even with the ones of you who have not done anything about machine learning yet, a new curiosity will be sparked. And you'll start taking a little deep dive into it. Doesn't need to be more than a couple days. So we all have that time, but it will increase your understanding of the topic. Why you need to spend more time on this topic, not just learning it, but applying it. Talking about it, encouraging other people to apply it, and how your organization can be better prepared. But I will not talk about AI overall, just talk about machine learning. I will not talk about which jobs AI will replace, which will be protected. I will not tell you where to apply machine learning. You are all experts. you're all professionals. You just need to use the tool that machine learning is in your work. But to have the idea that, hey, I have this problem, can I use machine learning to solve this problem? In order to have that idea, you need to know some of the basics. And then you can go to people who do it, you know, full time. Can I use machine learning? Okay, can we experiment? Can we pilot? Let's try. And then you learn. This is important. You need to learn and you need to act. It's that simple. So why is it topical right now? We have digitized so many different areas. And every time we digitize an area, we create huge amounts of data. We also add completely new services. Books are not what they used to be. I have been studying Chinese for the past 3 years. And it's so easy when you do it in a digital format, because you can just click on a word and you see what it means. I wouldn't learn as fast if I would just be using paper books. Travel, film, navigation. Do you still remember when we drove into an unfamiliar city with a paper map on our knees? And it was a nightmare. And nowadays, we take it for granted that we can even see where there's free parking spaces left, or what the gas price is at a given gas station. So new services, but huge loads of data. So digitization has created an explosion of data. And that's obviously what AI feeds on. So AI follows the curve of digitization. And we have many businesses that are barely starting to digitize themselves, like the experience you get when you go to a barber. Maybe you book the time over the web, but that's about the extent of digitization. Education is somewhat digitized, not too well typically, but AI is barely being thought of in their business. They may teach AI, but they don't use AI. And then there are different types of companies, including then the web-scale companies that are spending huge amounts of money on machine learning. And some AI specialists that are typically not as advanced as these web-scale companies. On this graph, you see the amount of teaching data available on the horizontal axis and sort of a subjective feel of the intelligence, intuition, output, the results that you get from the system on the vertical axis. And the vertical axis is a logarithmic scale. So if we take the most simple possible machine learning algorithm, like logistic regression, and it doesn't matter what it does, it's much more simpler than it sounds, you see that the curve becomes horizontal very early as you go towards the right. So it means that even if you have more teaching data, the algorithm is very limited because of its simplicity. It doesn't learn more. The error it makes doesn't become smaller, even if you teach it with more data. And its ability to understand or create value is very limited, doesn't go very high. And the amount of computational power required to teach it is very limited as well. But you can actually do some pretty decent stuff with a logistics regression algorithm for certain purposes. If you take a shallow neural network, the ability of it to learn is higher. You can get it to advance by feeding it more data a little bit longer. And it does require a little bit more computational power to learn. And the same for deeper neural networks. And then for more sophisticated architectures, where within each architecture you may be employing a number of neural networks and other methods. And the interesting thing is that if you have unlimited computational power, you can create neural network architectures that can basically learn forever if you have more and more high-quality teaching data, which means that the error it makes will get smaller. It doesn't get smarter. It just makes a smaller mistake. and there's a fundamental difference between the two. So there's no risk of creating a super being just by, you know, feeding more data and making a deeper network. But the amount of computational power for these large architectures is pretty significant. So now let's try to take a deep dive into what machine learning is. And I think today I have a very technical audience, so this will be easy for all of you. Don't worry that if you don't understand everything, it doesn't matter. The only idea is that you get an intuition of certain behaviors of these algorithms. So basically, all machine learning is answering a question of, can you build a model that will fit to the data that I'm feeding to you? And in this example, let's forget the numbers on the axes and think that we have two data points for an apartment. We have the price per square meter, and we have the number of square meters. And the question is, can I sell the apartment in less than a month? And here I have data, lots of apartments. I know the number of square meters in each, and I know the price per square meter. And I know how long it took to sell them. And now the colors tell me that the blue ones were sold in less than a month, and the red ones took longer. And now I'm asking the system to build a model that will fit to this data. And of course, it will create something like that. A human being could do it as well. We could just dabble with various algorithms and try to find one that would fit the data. But obviously, this is a flawed example, because nobody would believe that we could get a decent predictive capability just knowing the number of square meters and the price per square meter. We also should know the address and the age of the building, and if it's a high rise, how many levels, and on what level is this apartment, and when was it renovated last, and what is the view like, and 100 other parameters before we could really reliably predict how it will sell. And for a human being operating in a 100-dimensional space, try to figure the right algorithm to fit to the data would be just impossible. But for a machine, it doesn't matter how many dimensions. It's not more difficult in a 100-dimensional space than it is in a 2-dimensional space. It's more difficult only for us. The computer doesn't care. And therefore, we can feed a system pictures like this. And the question is, can you create a model that will fit the data so to tell me for a given picture if it's about skin cancer? This picture is about skin cancer, but we would feed the system also with pictures that are other types of skin ailments. And it's exactly the same problem as the apartment problem. It just looks different. And the input is pixels, pixel values, instead of prices per square meter. But it's the same, fundamentally the same topic. Or can you fit the model to the data so that the system can tell me what kind of an animal is in the picture? Exactly the same question. Different types of parameters. Or if a self-driving car captures this image in the forward-facing camera, is this just a pile of leaves blown by the wind, or is this something that should make us stop? Exactly the same kind of a question. Or this audio wave, what are the words that are being said? Can you fit the model to the data so that it can reliably predict the words that are being said? Exactly the same issue. So all machine learning is basically the same process, just with different tools and different input. So let's take the previous example. We have two inputs, square meters and price per square meter. And we'll now use the logistic regression, which was the lowest curve on the previous chart. So the most simple possible algorithm. But we'll use unlimited number of features or input parameters. And what we will do is we will give each input a weight. We will multiply the input with the given weight and add those, all those up. So the Greek character sigma there means just summing up all the values after it. And then we'll put it through a nonlinear algorithm, the only function of which is to change the sum, the value of the sum, to a value, in this case using sigmoid, value between minus 1 and plus 1, which is basically a probability. A probability between 0% and 100%. 1 being 100% and minus 1 being 0%. So the logistic regression gives us a probability for the given input being what we are asking the system to define. And it's kind of amazing that with this kind of an algorithm, this simple a thing, we can actually recognize, for example, handwritten digits. So here's an example. I have a data set of 5,000 handwritten digits, some of them such that it would be difficult for me to recognize them. So, for example, what is that? Is that a bad 8 or is it a 1? Or that one, is it a 6 or a 0? So we human beings, I think all of us, sometimes write characters in a pretty haphazard way. So 5,000 samples, 500 for each digit. And let's use logistic regression to identify these. So each one of these is a bitmap, 20 times 20 pixels. So basically 400 numeric values. These are grayscale characters, so there's only one value between 0 and 255. If there were color pictures, then there would be three values, one for red, one for green, and one for blue. Otherwise, it would be exactly the same. And it doesn't matter for the algorithm whether it's colored or grayscale. It's all the same. So we have 400 input values. Each pixel is an input value. And the funny thing is that we human beings don't realize that actually we see in a bit of a similar way, because we only sense the outcome after our brain processes it. But for the machine, all vision is just a bunch of numbers. And that's somehow a bit difficult to grasp. How can it see if we just give it a bunch of numbers? But we humans actually see in a little bit of a similar way. So we give it a bunch of numbers that represent the image. And we assign each number a weight. And then we'll multiply the input value, the pixel value, with the weight, and sum them all up, and put it through the nonlinear algorithm, which just changes it into a probability. And we'll do that 10 times, once for each digit. So we'll teach a logistic regression system to recognize the digit 0, and we teach another system to recognize the digits 1, and so forth. So we'll have a probability spread between the different digits as an outcome. And what it looks like, very simply, it doesn't look like much. So here we have the teaching. Now it's teaching the digit 1 and 2. It does 50 rounds of teaching. And the teaching is finding the right weights. So the system always starts with randomly assigned weights. And this is the magic of machine learning. Some bright guy 30 years ago figured out a way to find the right weights, the optimal weights. And of course the system is limited by its ability to learn. And logistic regression is very simple, so given these inputs, it learned to recognize these inputs at the rate of 95%. And this is not, of course, the ability of the system to recognize handwritten digits. This is only the ability of it to recognize the digits with which it was taught. So to actually figure out how good it is, we should have another set of handwritten digits that we give to it, that it has never seen before. And then we can see how good it is in real life. But now we have taught it, and we saw that it could achieve a fair capability in recognizing. But it was not good enough, so let's take a little bit more complicated algorithm. So we'll take a neural network. So again, we have the 400 input pixels, pixel values, and this time we'll just build a single model, and it will give the probability for each digit at one go. And the only difference to the logistic regression is that we'll add a middle layer. It's called a hidden layer, because basically you see the input values and you see the output values, but you don't typically know or care what's happening in the middle. So this is the hidden layer. And in a deep learning model, there are just a number of hidden layers. So it becomes a deep stack of layers. That's the reason for the word deep learning. And in this case, we'll do a fully connected neural network. So we have a connection between all input pixels to all these, in this case, 25 hidden layer cells. And then we'll do a fully connected connection to the output layer. So again, all the 25 hidden level cells are connected to each one of the output cells. And we'll do the multiplication and the sum both for the hidden layer and the output layer, exactly as with logistic regression. So the way this works is we first start with random weights. We calculate the outcome. We know what it should have been because we know what image we gave to the system. We calculate how big an error it did. And then we'll nudge all the weights a little bit in the right direction to reduce the error made. And then we'll just keep on repeating that. We again calculate with the new weights, we calculate the error made, we nudge all the weights a little bit in the right direction, and then we do the same again. And you could see when I ran the small program for logistic regression, you could see how the error got smaller. There was this running number that was getting smaller and smaller. It started higher, and when it finished the 50 rounds of learning, it had gotten consecutively smaller. And this is all that machine learning is. So basically, understanding logistic regression enables you to understand much, much more sophisticated models in principle. There's a lot of added complexity, but you don't need to know about that to have the intuition, both of the capabilities and the limitations of machine learning. So let's assume that we have a fully trained neural network trying to recognize the number 8. So what we hope would be the outcome is something like this. So a very low probability for all the other numbers, and then a 98.8% probability for the digit 8. This would be a good model, functional model. So how would that be possible? It would require the number to be given to the nonlinear sigmoid function to be as high as possible. Because to get to 98.8, we should be somewhere around 6 or 7, and that's a high number in this case. If we would get to 100 or 1,000, of course, it would be even better. Because it approaches the number one asymptotically as you get the higher number. So if the model works well, the cell of the number 8 results in a high number. And that means that the weights and the values that connect to the number 8 should be as high as possible, so that the sum of them would be as high as possible. So these weights and these input values. And of course, some of them won't matter to the number 8. Some of them, the middle layer cells specialize in recognizing other numbers or other types of shapes. But some of them are really relevant and they should have a high weight. So if the system works well, it finds weights that create the required result. But of course, the middle layer values are the result of a similar calculation, which we did based on the pixel values and the weights given to them. And as we have 400 pixel values and 25 middle layer cells, we have 400 times 25 weights, so 10,000 weights for the first layer. And then 25 times 10, 250 weights for the second one. So the whole process of learning is to figure out the right values for those parameters, for those weights. And then there's this plus b, but you don't need to worry about that. It doesn't really matter. So we have a little bit over 10,000 parameters, which is nothing. When I was coding in the 80s, I often had to wait a long time. Some of you are old enough to have done it at that time as well. And I was just, even if I intellectually knew how fast these computers are, I was just blown away by the speed of this crappy old laptop that I'm using doing the calculations. So let's see how much better a neural network is doing this. So here's a fully trained neural network. I'm not training it now. It was trained previously. So it achieved 97.5 accuracy. And here I have some of the numbers. And you can see the prediction. It was 8. And here's the right answer. It was really 8, according to the human being who looked at the number and annotated the input data. Of course, the human person could have made a mistake as well, in which case we would have taught the system with flawed data, which often happens, or actually almost always happens. And we can try other numbers. That's a 4, that's right answer 7, that's right answer 8, and so forth. So it seems to work pretty reliably. So clearly a better outcome than with the logistic regression. The question is, how does this really work? And I have a bonus question. Can anybody tell me how this same neural network would work if it only had 10 hidden layer cells? The ones of you who have dabbled with this should figure out the answer. Anybody dare to risk an answer? I'll let you think about that. So we have 400 input values and we have 400 weights to those 400 input values. The 400 input values form a picture. If you just put them through the right algorithm, you can display on a display the picture that those values form. So in this case, let's take the weights and treat them as image pixel values. And as the system learns and those weights are slowly move towards the optimal, we can see how the shape changes. We can sort of see how the system thinks. Because we can convert those multipliers to grayscale values, and we start with a random value, so it's noise. This is a noise picture. This is the starting point. And as it learns, the weights change and we can see the change. So we start with the same numbers. And now we are training it. And you can see a single middle layer cell through the 400 weights that connect to it. And you can see it learning. And with good intentions, you can try to imagine that the shape you see forming is indicative of the value that that particular cell brings to the objective of recognizing handwritten characters. In image recognition, in a multi-layer neural network, the first layer detects basic shapes, curves, horizontal lines, vertical lines, different types of shapes. And then the deeper layers collect a higher level understanding, i.e. a combination of those basic shapes. So you could think of, for example, for facial recognition, the deeper layers recognizing noses, ears, chins, foreheads. And then a deeper layer still will start to put those components together to recognize individual faces. And you can imagine that you can see how this learning happens and these shapes are formed. And you can see the cost going down. This is very, very slow because I'm always doing only one round of learning, then I'm stopping it and I'm updating the picture and then I'm starting it again. So it's extremely slow. But you can see the error it makes getting consecutively smaller. If we just wait long enough, we'll get to a better outcome than the one that we saw in the previous example. So now we understand how a neural network learns. And it is not less wonderful or curiosity arousing than this. This is extremely interesting. And it's very difficult to try to visualize what a real deep neural network or a higher level architecture, how it really works. But it's fascinating. It's truly fascinating. But at the same time, it is a very simple concept. In this particular case, we did 205 trillion calculations in the learning phase. The new processor announced 3 weeks ago by NVIDIA called Pegasus does 420 trillion operations per second. And it's created for this particular purpose. So 205 trillion calculations is not that much. And this is a very small model. In a large neural network, you can have 100 million parameters at a single layer. So this was really, really small. This was tiny. So has anybody a theory what the model would do if it only had 10 hidden layer cells? If it only had 10 hidden layer cells, then the hidden layer cells couldn't specialize in doing anything else but each one of them recognizing a single digit. In which case, from the middle layer cells, there would be one link to the output cells with a high weight, and the other links would have a weight of basically zero. The second phase wouldn't do anything. It couldn't add any value anymore, because we only have 10 cells in the middle layer. Now we had 25, so they can do something else than just try to recognize a single digit. What they do, what they specialize doing, we don't know. The system itself decides how they specialize, and that's the fascinating thing. If we would put 40 cells in the middle layer, they would specialize doing something else than they did now with 25. So a neural network works the way that we first collect some high-quality annotated data. We choose the right approach. We initialize the parameters. We calculate the outcome with the random values that we initialize the system with. We measure the error to the training samples. We nudge all parameters in all layers towards the minimum of the cost function. So we try to minimize the error, which is called cost. We calculate the outcome again using the nudged parameter values. And then we go back to step 6, as long as we can decrease the error, or as long as we feel that we have come to a low enough error. And just for time-saving sake, we stop the learning process. And when we finish, the final parameter values, the weights, are the best ones or good enough ones achievable with the current setup. So then we test the network with the test data that we didn't use to teach it, so we can really see how well it performs in sort of real life. If the outcome is not acceptable, if it's not good enough, we either need to go to back to one to collect more data. If we have a complex system and it can continue to learn more with more data, maybe more data will help. Or we initialize it differently, we add more cells to the hidden layers, or we do something else. Or we choose a completely different architecture, a different model. And then we do it again. If we were happy at stage 11, we have a production system that we can start using. And it's this simple every time. In practice, it's a lot about experimentation. Not even the best experts can say what approach will be the right one. You need to try, and that's time consuming. And you need to be smart about it. Sometimes you waste months of work by trying to, for example, collect high-quality data, and in the end, that's not the important part, it's something else. And just to remind you that it's not this simple, of course, the real architectures are much more complicated, so I'm not going to go into this, but this is a picture of a convolutional network, which is typically used for image recognition, and there are two additional elements to the neural networks here. There's the convolution itself, which is sort of filtering, and then there's a pooling function. And these are alternated before we get to the end, where we have a fully connected neural network. And then the outcome of, for example, classifying animal images to the different species or something similar. Here's a long-term, short-term memory. And the point is that one of the limitations of the basic neural network is that it doesn't have any memory. It doesn't remember what it did previously. It only knows the weights it has at the given time. That's the only parameter it has. So if we use it to build a sentence, one word at a time, we have a neural network that has in its output layer enough cells to have one cell for each word. So it has a lot of output cells. But for it to be able to build a sentence one word at a time, it needs to remember what was the previous word and the one before that, so that the words fit together. So this is a system which has a memory. And then 2-3 years ago, somebody came up with this generative adversarial network model, which is a fascinating sort of a self-teaching system, which creates its own learning data. You feed it with a little original learning data, but mostly generates it itself. It's not really being used for that much in production environments at the moment, but lots of research is being, and experiments are being carried out on that. A fascinating model. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get into how they work. And then, of course, you combine these types of more sophisticated architectures to build systems of systems. And that's really what does the real work. So it does get quite a bit more complicated, as any software does, when you build bigger systems. But each module is just as simple as they are in other types of software. We can easily understand each building block, even if it sometimes is difficult to see the forest from the trees. So I hope I was able to give you, the ones of you who have not done this before, an intuition of how machine learning works. It's all about finding the right weights, the right values for the parameters. But what does it mean? Well, first of all, Moore's law still seems to be chugging on, at least for a while. Maybe it's becoming more linear, but we are getting more computational power and we're getting better processors for this purpose. And let's take Alexa's speech training. So Amazon's Alexa, some of you must have that, and it speaks English or understands English pretty well. It has been trained with 16,000 hours of human talk. And funnily enough, that's about the same amount of data or voice or talk that a 16-year-old teenager has heard in his or her life. So twisting the facts a little bit, you can claim that Alexa has been taught with the same data set that a typical 16-year-old human. And while a human takes 16 years to learn that, what would you guess a couple of years ago with the 80 course in AWS, how long it took to teach Alexa with 16,000 hours of voice? It took about 2 hours. So 2 hours versus 16 years. That's the power of computing. We humans can't input that much data very efficiently. We take a long time. The machine can do it very quickly. Of course, we learn better, much better, at a completely different level in 16 years than what Alexa can do in 2 hours. But in a few years' time, it will be 5 minutes. This is getting better and better. We are not getting better. We will stay the same. Better tools. Google released TensorFlow. Facebook released Cafe 2. Alexa has something called SkillsKit. It's an API that third parties can use to add functionality to Alexa. So for example, if you want to use your Alexa to call an Uber car, Uber has built that extension. Amazon didn't need to do it. So they have thousands of companies adding functionality to Alexa. It's a platform, it's an ecosystem. And it gets more versatile, new services because of that. It's interesting to think why Google and Google and Facebook have released their AI frameworks. And I have asked somebody to look into the T's and C's of those systems because I want to know what they say about their right to the data that is being used to train the system built with those frameworks. I haven't received an answer yet, but it might be that they have some rights to the data that we upload to their system to teach a machine learning solution that we have built. But in any case, even if they don't get any rights to the data, they must feel that the actual AI technology is not the decisive factor in competitiveness. It's the data that you have to teach it with. And of course, they have access to huge amounts of data. Facebook to 1.6 billion people and lots of their data. Google to all the search data and videos and so forth. Apple and Huawei have both designed AI chips to put into the end device. So we can basically pretty soon do much of this calculation at the end device. We don't need to upload the user data to a data center. And of course, we will be bringing computational power to the edge of the network. So maybe it will be done there without needing to upload the data into a big data center. But data is the new oil. But we are also limited by the system. So as you could easily see, we are truly very far away from a generic intelligence. But at the same time, we can do a lot of things with machine learning that humans are really struggling to do, or that is impossible for humans to do. So while the technology is severely limited in many ways, it still can be far superior in many tasks that humans do. Here you see pictures of two tanks. On the left, Abrams, the bleeding edge US battle tank. On the right hand side, a fairly old Soviet tank, T-72. Some of you may be familiar with it if you did your military service in Finland. Or Israel, yes. I was in the anti-tank troops. That's why this is very close to my heart. Oh, you were a tank commander. Oh, very good to meet you. So the US were building a system to recognize enemy tanks in the battlefield. So they taught the system with these nice pictures they got from the US tank manufacturers, and then telephoto lens pictures taken at exercises somewhere for the Russian tanks. And the system learned what it was taught to learn, i.e. it learned to recognize high quality pictures from low quality pictures. And think about when you take that system into use on the battlefield during a foggy day. And every picture is a low quality picture. I wouldn't want to be a tank commander that morning. So garbage in, garbage out. And this is a reference to a Chinese research experiment where the researchers were apparently trying to prove that you can't recognize criminals from their faces. And they taught the system with a load of pictures from the penal system and a load of pictures from other sources. And to their surprise, the system learned to recognize the criminals. And of course, this is a wonderful thing when you apply for your driver's license and they get your picture. Some of you will go to jail immediately and some of you will get the driver's license. So it's a wonderful predictive system, but a bit scary as well. If it does an error rate of 15%, let's say. So again, surprising results. At the same time, better than anybody could have imagined, but scary. And completely unusable. As you saw, the system typically gives a probability for something being A or B or C. So Google has created a huge library of images and probabilities for those images for being a cat or a dog or a house or a bulldozer. What would you think is the picture that has the highest probability of being a cat? So the cattiest cat in the world, according to Google. What would be the most cat? It's of course a group of cats. Because obviously a group of cats have more features that are cat-like than a single cat. But a human being would never give that answer. You were immediately thinking about the fuzziest, nicest looking kitten that you can think of. The machine doesn't think like that. It doesn't know about cute, unless it has been taught what cute is. So you come up with surprising outcomes. Of course, the system can be taught to identify or separate between a single animal and a group of animals, but this one was not taught to separate between the two. Here's a picture of a panda. The system recognizes it as a panda with a probability of 57%. Here's a sort of a very noisy picture. If we add the pixel values of this picture multiplied with 0.007, so a very, very faint image, almost invisible to the pixel values of the original panda, we get this outcome, which looks exactly like the original picture to human eyes. But to the system, it's 99.3% probability it's a gibbon. So when you know how the system works, you can fool it. Because when you tweak the original pixel values a little bit, given the weights that the system has learned, the multiplications will end up being slightly different, and it becomes a gibbon. While for human eyes, it's obviously the same picture than the original one. So every time you use a machine learning system, somebody can play that system if they have enough access to the system so that they can try multiple times different things. They can distort the outcomes. AlphaGo, not the latest one, but the previous one, the one that beat the number one player in the world, it has been taught with enough games that for a human being to play that number of games, it would mean that we would have to play for 3,000 years. So obviously, AlphaGo, while it did beat the number one player in the world, it had to use more human time than any human is able to. And if a human being could play for 3,000 years, I would bet that we would find somebody who could beat AlphaGo. Now they have a new version that learns much faster, uses less computing capacity to learn, and it was able to beat the previous best version 100 games out of 100 games. And it only took 2 weeks or so for it to achieve that level of learning, with only 4 processors being used to teach it. Here's Microsoft's attempt at using AI to communicate through Twitter. The system learned from the Twitter messages that were sent to it, and garbage in, garbage out. When the system started responding that Hitler did nothing wrong, Microsoft took it offline. So again, we need to, when we understand, when we have the intuition of how machine learning works, it's obvious to us that these outcomes are possible. If you don't have that intuition, you may be badly surprised. You can't preempt that things can go wrong in this way. So it is important to have that intuition. Then if we think about AI versus humans, we have the bottom left-hand corner where we get little data, but we can answer very quickly. So for example, is this a cat? We don't need to think about it. The machine doesn't need to think about it much either. It's pretty easy. What breed of a cat is this? People who are into cats can say that very quickly. The machine can do it as well. Translating languages. Rengung, Junang, artificial intelligence, or man-made intelligence. Very easy for humans to do, quickly. We see the text, we immediately know what it means. Machine can do the same. Is this cancer? Machines can do it better. With just high-resolution picture, we can teach a machine with thousands and thousands of those pictures. A human doctor will take a long time to experience the same. We can just put more data into the machine, then it can see with a higher resolution than a human person. But humans are pretty good at that as well. Then there's basically nothing in the right hand bottom corner because we are rarely giving quick answers when there's lots of data. When there's lots of data, either we are too often wrong if we give quick answers, or we need to think for a long time. Will he click on this link? This is how Google works. When you are shown a page and you see certain ads, certain links to ads on that page, Google has sorted all the ad inventory it has into the order of probability that you as an individual will click on them. And of course it will show the ones with the highest probability to you. And that's how it makes billions. That's AI or machine learning in production use. Humans couldn't do that. Impossible. Will he replay the loan for a loan officer at the bank? If there's enough data about you, the machine will be much, much better than a human being in assessing your ability to pay it back. If there's not that much data, then the human being can be better. Although they can be biased as well. Is this fraudulent? A money transfer? Machines are better at detecting the odd bits of data. Humans can be pretty good at something that requires a lot of thinking. Is this a good strategy? But basically a machine learning system could do that as well. Understanding a lot about the environment, the market changes, the dynamics, the competition, reading so much data about everything. And it could be pretty good. Are we under cyber attack? A lot of data. And we know better than anybody how much data we see from the network. Very hard for a human being to process even a fraction of that data. The machine could process it all. We could basically build a model, an algorithm for clean traffic. If we could do that, then everything else would be malicious traffic. Not easy to do, because the variety of different traffic patterns is so huge, and new ones are being formed as new applications and formats and protocols are being invented. But basically doable. But then there are some things that are really difficult for machine learning, like applying something it learns in one domain to a completely different domain. So we can easily teach a machine to be an expert in Sun Tzu. But how do we apply those learnings in business is a completely different thing. Or what are gravitational waves? Well, now we know what they are, or we know a little bit more as they have been actually detected. But before they were detected, I mean, it's just somebody imagining what they might be. And machine learning can't do that. If we teach a machine learning system to recognize everybody here in the room, it can do that. But we can't ask it to describe you. It can't do that. It can't go from the output towards the input. If you think about the mathematical model, it doesn't end up with your description if you somehow go back from right to left in the diagrams. It can't do that. We can do that easily. So very limited in many ways. So what I would want companies to do is to spread the understanding, the intuition of what machine learning is, so that all the experts in our company, for example, can identify problems that could be solved with machine learning when they see them, because they have the intuition of what machine learning can do and what it cannot do. And then we would need to have a competence center, people that we can go to, asking them, can we really solve this problem using machine learning? Can you help me? Can we experiment? And we need to have a data strategy. We need to have a holistic understanding of all the data that we can access. And we need to have real access to that data so that we can combine the different data sets we have in order to teach a machine learning system. But that's not enough. We need to also have a firm understanding of what kind of data do we need in 3 years or 5 years' time in order to teach the machine learning system that will define our competitiveness at that time. And maybe we need to act right now in order to get access to that data in 3 years' time. If you only start finding that data when we need it, we may be badly late. So, for example, every single customer contract we have should be reviewed from this point of view. Our customers don't want us to have too much access to their data, but we need to push that boundary, and we need to figure smart ways even to pay for the data. Sometimes the data can be the most valuable thing, much more valuable than an individual customer relationship in the long term. Oftentimes it's in the customer's interest to share the data with us, because by teaching our systems we can serve the customer better. We just need to make them understand this. We need to apply machine learning widely for increased efficiency, for better quality. We can save so much time, we can do better work, and we can do higher quality work using machine learning. And of course we need to embed machine learning into our products and services so that we can serve our customers better. If we do these five things, we'll be much better off. Understanding, having the competence, having access to data, having a holistic understanding of all the data that we have. We apply it internally and we apply it externally. Simple as that. And finally, we need to understand that new technology requires us to behave differently as well. So this is from Andrew Ng, who's one of the best AI researchers in the world, and the guy whose face I have been watching for hundreds of hours on video, teaching the machine language or machine learning courses. So he said that you need to realize that an internet company is not what a shopping mall becomes when they add a website. And that's obvious, because an internet company thinks differently and behaves differently. One example is A/B testing. So when an internet company is thinking about what is the best way to increase sales in showing products for shoppers, they don't escalate that to the management team for them to decide. They immediately try. They have 10,000 customers see a particular kind of a page, and 10,000 customers see a slightly different page, and they know that with this page we got 4.2% more sales. And the person making that decision is fairly low down in the company. The technical expert, the one managing that portion of the website. You need to empower people, technical experts, to make decisions, to make experiments in a very different way than traditional companies do. And you do it with very short cycles. You don't have time for meetings or committees, or you just do it constantly. And this is obvious for anybody who's worked in such a company. And in AI companies, a traditional tech company like us, we don't become an AI company when we start using neural networks. We're just as far from an AI company as a department store is from a web-based company. Because AI companies behave very differently. They automatically, of course, have centralized data warehousing. This single view to all the data doesn't need to, or will not be physically centralized, but it will be logically centralized. They do strategic data acquisition. That's as automatic to them as A/B testing is for an internet company. They think that way. It's who they are. We need to learn to think that way, even if we don't want to become an AI company as such. And they automate everything they can. That's the hammer that they have in their hand, and everything they see are nails. That's their DNA. And obviously they have a new way to organize, and they have new job descriptions. And this is all because our operating environment is changing. We have a low complexity, low predictability environment, which is basically throwing dice. It's chance. No predictability. Very simple. We have a high predictability, low complexity environment, which I call simple. That's, some of you remember the video game called Donkey Kong. It works exactly the same way every time. You can play it with your eyes closed, just learn the right rhythm, and you'll become very good at that. It's a simple task. Anyone can do that. Just practice a little bit. If I would ask you to code Donkey Kong, it would be more complicated. Very predictable, but complicated. You would need to learn the programming environment and learn coding, but you could do that. But then if I would ask you to code the best-selling game on the App Store, no one knows how to do that. It's completely unpredictable. Nobody can predict how the consumers will behave with the next new type of game. And this is the kind of a world where we will be more and more. It will be complicated and unpredictable. And we need to learn to experiment much more. And AI is all about experimenting. We can't experiment if we don't do that rapidly. We can't do it rapidly if we don't empower our people, the technical experts in the organization. So it sort of logically flows down. If that's the environment, we need to behave in a certain way. We need to organize in a certain way. We need to empower in a certain way. We need to think in a certain way. I think strategy will become a different kind of a process, a creation of alternatives. We think of different ways things could happen. We experiment, and then we form a strategy. Not the other way around. The old ways that we first create a strategy, then we start perhaps experimenting with something. I think this will need to be thought in a different order. And then we improve and think of alternatives and experiment and polish our strategy. So, in summary, an intuition why now? Computing capacity and data increase. Significant business results already achieved. Huge investments into machine learning from multiple players. Unfortunately, mostly in the US and China. Unfortunately for Europe. And we need to become better fast. Intuition, what machine learning is. Building a model to reliably predict the right outcome based on a set of input data. And that's all it is. The machine builds the model. Slow in the learning phase, very, very quick in production use. Only thinks in one direction. And garbage in, garbage out. Why is this important? Because the amount of data and computing capacity will just continue to increase. New algorithms will be invented. Maybe even a new way to learn. Something that could be bi-directional. Something that you could ask, what does the guy look like? Instead of just the system recognizing the person. Something where you can transfer learning between one domain to another. A more generic intelligence. But that requires a completely new way for these systems to learn. The current way of learning is not capable of that. And then the five steps that we all should follow. And the final thing to think about, if we agree that intelligence is a function of the physical world, i.e. it's not a function of God or some metaphysical being, and we believe that technology will continue to improve, then some people feel that it's very logical that there will be an intelligence explosion. It's only a question of time. Because we will figure out the algorithms that are being used by our brain. We can just copy them. We don't need to invent something that doesn't exist. Generic intelligence exists in our brains. We implement something like that with computers that are getting faster and faster all the time. And that have much more data to use than we have. and there will be a superhuman level being one day. Now I'll leave you with that thought, but I hope that you will first do the five things that we discussed before we start too much worrying about the intelligence explosion. Thank you very much.